So you're crazy enough to want to try an Everesting attempt, and I want to help you crush it. I want to help you win, and so do these crazy people right here in the costumes. And one of the keys to any Everesting challenge is distractions and having fun, and they clearly knew how to put that together. So hi, I'm Brian Stevens, and I have failed at Everesting attempts, and I've been successful at Everesting attempts. And today I'm going to focus on only virtual Everesting, which is not doing an Everesting outside, but you know, on your trainer, and I'm only going to focus on the bike. You can do it as a run or a bike. I'm only going to focus on a trainer, and I'm going to really focus on Swift in that particular app on how you Everesting. But first and foremost, what the heck is an Everesting attempt? And these great people at Everesting have basically set the rules and the guidelines for what the attempt is. And it's basically, in short, you pick any climb in the world, or on Swift, you pick a climb, one of the many climbs on Swift, and you do repeats up and down that hill in a single activity until you reach the equivalent of climbing Mount Everest, which is just over 29,000 feet, about 8,848 meters. And then they, if you accomplish that on trainer outside, they have this really awesome like Hall of Fame. You could submit your stats there, and it's a really cool, crazy, nutty thing to do. And there are multiple levels of Everesting. And the first one is what's called a base camp, which is half a full Everesting. And it's like the equivalent of climbing up to base camp at Mount Everest, which is really, really tough. Like, I'm not trying to say like it's half an Everesting, so it's nothing. It is really, really hard to do indoors or outdoors. And it's 14,400 feet, give or take. And so we're going to talk about a base camp and a full Everesting on Swift. I want to talk to you about some of the pre-things I've learned, the things you should be doing before you make your attempt, and then kind of the day of activities and some of the tips and tricks that I and others have learned to make it very successful. So first, check out this website. And it will give you right here all the rules and guidelines for when you do it, because you want to do it the right way so that you get credit for it and you're meeting the challenge of other people that have done this all around the world and on their crazy trainers, just like you're getting ready to do. And so read those rules. I'm going to hit some of the critical rules now as we go in this video. Like, one, it's got to be a single activity, and it's up and down the same climb, and you can't go to sleep unless it's like a double Everesting. I ain't talking about that. If you want to do that, you better go read the rules, and you better figure it out on your own and then tell me how to do it, all right? So, but here are the rules and the guidelines and all that. So you can read that on your own. But the first thing that you need to do is figure out what climb you're going to do and how many times you got to go up and down it to reach the distance that you want. But they've come up with this handy dandy, like awesome calculator right here on their site. And so menu, hit calculator, pull it up, and they give it to you. And look at all this great information. They're going to tell you, you're going to kind of calculate how long it's going to take you to do a climb, how long it's going to take you to drop, and you'll figure out, you know, how fast, how long it's going to take you, which is really neat. Now, the only thing that's a real pain in the butt is finding this segment or route URL or the ID number. I couldn't find it on my iPad. I couldn't find it on my phone. And it's sometimes you think you found it and you didn't. But let me show you exactly how to get it. So you pull up the Strava segment that you're thinking about. And I'm going to talk about two potential climbs on Swift. And you can look at the others if you'd like. But I think these are the two that kind of work best for me anyway. And the first one is the Alpe d'Huez, which is a climb that parallels the Alpe d'Huez, which is a climb in the Tour de France occasionally, and it's just a climb with all these massive switchbacks. And there are all these people that have done both the Swift version and the Royal version. Say they're really, really similar, with the exception of like rain and wind and everything, right? On one, you have boredom because you're on the trainer, and the other one, you have the elements outside. So I don't know which one's harder. I haven't done them both. But this is a climb that a lot of people like to use to get their base camp or their full Swift Everesting attempt accomplished. It's got pros and cons. First off, it's long. And I know some people can do it under an hour. I can do it under an hour, but not when I'm trying to do multiple laps. I can. If God bless you if you can, right? But most of us probably take over an hour, especially when you have to do it up and down over and over again. So it's just a lot to think about. Every single time you hit the bottom of the climb, you've got an hour plus to wrap up a full climb. And here's another rule. Once you start a climb, you got to finish it. You can't do like halfway up and downs over and over until you get the distance. They want you to do the full climb from base to summit every single time. So that means you're kind of committed to get all the way up to the top of this climb. And I did a base camp on this. I was trying to do a full Everest. I ended up doing a base camp, right? And I failed on the full Everest attempt because the climb was just a lot for me mentally to suck up. The most I'd ever done on a trainer was 6 hours. And it was going to be 13, 14 hours on it. And I violated some of the rules that I'm gonna try to explain to you. So I finished a base camp on it. It was just a lot to stomach. So you take this little number right here, this little number that's highlighted. You move it to your calculator. Boom. And you hit calculate. Now, right here on this button here, you have the different options they're going to let you know. Full Everest, a base camp, and the 10 Clay Club, which is about 33,000 feet. So it's a little bit more than a full Everest attempt. So for the, I'm going to make sure that I have the right climb on here. So this is the one for the, okay, I got the Epic KOM in here twice, I think, guys. I'm sorry about that, the Epic KOM twice. But if you take this, let's just do it real quick. So you take this number, you highlight it. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to put it in my calculator right here. I'm going to delete this guy. I'm going to put it in, and I'm going to be able to look at this climb. And this is the Alpe d'Huez. And look, it tells me exactly how many ups and downs I've got to go. It's 8.5 times. I love these people at Everesting. And it tells you the total distance. And if you put how long you're going to take to climb it right in here, it will start to calculate for you how long it will take you to do the Everesting attempt, right? So this is what's really important here. Go climb these. Go get in Swift, get on your trainer, bang out a climb, do it in your Z2, which I think fundamentally is the right pace, especially for the first few hours to stay in that low Z2, and then you can kind of build up. If you're really fit and really aggressive, maybe you can, you know, go into sweet spot or something like that. I really focused for my full Everesting on mid Z2, and then I got a little stronger as the day went. I didn't try to do high Z2 and then back down. I like negative splits as I was going along. It just mentally felt better. But put in how long you think it'll take you to climb, how long the descent took you when you turned around and roll back down the Alpe d'Huez, and it'll start to tell you exactly how long the estimated time was. Pretty accurate stuff. Now, I, on my full Everesting challenge, couldn't stomach this climb. It just, every single time, up and down in the descent, it kind of drug on me. So I started looking at the other climbs, and I ultimately arrived at the Epic KOM Reverse. It's a little less mileage, and it's a little steeper than the regular Epic KOM, and I think that really helps because the pros, Phil Gammon, and all these other people that crush an Everesting in like really short amount of time want the steepest climb possible in the fewest miles. I get that, but I'm a rank amateur. I imagine if you're watching this video, you're an amateur also. So pick something you can finish, and this is another rule for you. It doesn't matter how long it takes you. There's no guideline. If it takes you 24 hours, 36 hours, whatever it is, you just can't go to sleep on anything less than a double Everesting. So no sleep time. Get it done. Take your time and just crush it, all right? And so I picked this climb because, and here was the little code again for it. Put it in my little calculator. And the basic attempt was, oh, shoot, let me try to get this up here for you guys. Copy this. Put it into the calculator again. Calculate. I think this gets it. Epic KOM Reverse. And it was 20 laps. But each lap was only like 25, 28, 23 minutes. So I could stomach every climb a little easier, and it gave me a little bit more intermittent breaks. You decide what's right for you. Go test those Yorkshire climbs and York climbs. The volcano climb. People have done that on that. It's going to be more laps. You just got to decide what's right for you, but go and test those climbs, figure out when you're climbing Z2, how long it takes you, and then use a calculator to kind of do the math. And I think that's a really neat way to figure out what you're doing. So they've done such a great job here with all the calculations and the rules. So go check out the site. Now, let's talk about other things you need to be doing before the ride. The first time I did it as a base camp, I did it by myself, solo. It was miserable. It was hard. I don't recommend that. Maybe that's one of the reasons why I bailed after doing a base camp and didn't complete the whole thing. But the next time, told a couple people, and we decided to do it as a fundraiser, and we're doing it again this year, so it's our second annual, and we're doing it to help support the fight against breast cancer, and we're doing it in conjunction with a great group called, you know, C2She and a bunch of other people to raise money, and I think that kind of keeps people extra motivated. And so, unlike the first time where we had no support, the second time ended up having crazy stuff.
As they're riding.
This is a local group, 901 Racing, and they like rode through the barn that we were doing it in and just acted goofy, and it really broke things up very nicely. And we ended up it just any kind of distraction you can get, I think, is really critical. So having great people swing by and do, you know, goofy things like this, you know, this is what you're going to look like at the end of the day for sure, right? And so have some beverages there, right? And you know, I had a, you know, pit crew people helping work on the bike. And so this leads me into my next pro tip for you. Look at your equipment. Get your gear all set up. And I will say this. You've got to put your Swift difficulty all the way to max. You've got to pull it all the way over there so you can feel a simulated climb. You can't have it low or mid. It's kind of cheating. So don't do that. And I did not check my some of my equipment the day before, and my rocker thing was unbalanced. And these guys like just jumped in there and like fixed it. All things I could have done the day before. Also, gearing. You need lots of gears. Don't try to be a He-Man or He-Woman. God gave us gears for a reason. Use them. And as the day goes by and you start to get fatigued, you may want to be, you know, really keeping up the rotation of those pedals, and you want as many gear options as possible because I want you to finish. So if it's not on a smart bike like this, your regular bike, pick the bike that has the most gears. Put a bigger cassette on the back if you need to. Have plenty of gears, all right? And I think that's really critical for this attempt. The other thing you need to do before you get started is fans. Now, you're riding indoors, and that's going to you're going to sweat a lot. And I don't have one fan. Have multiple fans and really create a lot of airflow. We ended up having we did it during the winter for the second time, and it was great. Had the doors open. It was super cold in there. Lots of fans. Everyone that wasn't riding was like shivering with a jacket. But so what? They ain't riding. You riding. You know, you want a cool place with a lot of fans because you're going to sweat. And that kind of gets us to turn to a few tips on nutrition, which is have everything you can think of. I have to do kind of solid foods, you know, the first 5, 6, 7 hours on a long ride. And then I got to switch to liquids, more gels and things like that later on. But I ended up wanting potato chips and pickle juice and all those other things. So have a variety, because what you don't want is in hour 10 or 11 or whatever it is, and you're looking at it and you're saying, God, I really wish I had this. Just have it all laid out. Have it ready to go. And don't just drink water. I know it. Maybe you're doing it during the winter. Maybe it's cool. You're inside. You've got AC. You need electrolytes. You need those salt things to keep you going. It's a long ride. All right. So make sure that you really dig in to your food and nutrition. Check your equipment. And I would say that if you don't have the companion app, and the companion app is the little blue Swift looking app right there next to the other Swift. The companion app will allow you to dialogue with other people and talk with them, and they'll like give you ride-ons, and sometimes they'll end up riding with you, especially if you do the next awesome tip. Forget where I learned this from, but if you'll see right here, when you're doing an Everesting the day before, go and change your name. So, you know, your name show up here on Swift over here on the right side, and you put Everest before your name. So Everest Stevens, or, you know, Everest Brian, whatever you want to put on there. And people will know you're Everesting, and they will ride with you. It's a very supportive community out there, and people will ride with you, give you ride-ons, they'll know what you're doing, and it makes it a lot more fun, and once again, it creates even more distractions. So I would also have extra kits available. So when you make it to the top of a climb, you're going to descend immediately, and so you need to know how to use your U-turn button. If you don't know, you know, post it in the comment or ask a friend, but I want you to practice before you start day of, because right when you get to the top of the Abitus or whatever climb you pick, do an immediate U-turn. Don't waste your time, you know, doing the flat lands on the, like the Alpe du Swift, doing that flat land rotation. You don't get any credit for that. You don't have to do it. You just have to make it to the apex of the climb. Do an immediate U-turn, start descending. When you descend, you can get off the bike. You can change clothes. You can wash up. You just can't go to sleep. And so you can change kits if you need to. And change kits 2 or 3 times. Make sure you're comfortable. Have an extra pair of shoes in case one of the cleats go wrong. Don't let one of those simple little things go bad because you didn't have like extra food, extra hydration, extra kits ready to go, you know, extra electrolytes, backup shoes, and big fans that will cool you off and freeze everyone else out of the room, right? And the last thing that I would say as far as preparing is I do want to show you one extra thing that I don't think I qualified. I want to make sure that you know that if you're doing a base camp, which is awesome, it's a great start, you click this button right here and you could switch to a base camp or a 10K. So for full Everest, it was 20.1 laps. For a base camp, it's 10.1, right? So just make sure you look at all that and go practice those climbs. Now, let's get into the day of. Day of tips. You need to take screenshots of your effort. So it's possible you could lose your Wi-Fi or you could have a computer image. And the great people at Everstein will allow you to take your screenshots and show proof that you completed all the distance the day of. So you just constantly, every single time I got to the top of a climb or even mid-climb, take screenshots. Put a little something on your computer or your iPad to remind you to take screenshots. I would hate for you to get to 20,000 feet or if you're doing a base camp, 14,000 feet and your computer go down. And then you like scream and you start breaking everything inside. Like, I don't want that to happen to you, right? So take screenshots. Understand how to do U-turn. Tell other people. Get those distractions and make sure you're pounding in the food. Pacing the climb. Once again, if you got a coach, you've got friends, talk to them about it. But I would start in the low Z2, like very comfortable, but you can't be Z1. You can't be just noodling because you want to get it done, right? And then I'd ramp up your speed as you're feeling better and better and better and getting closer to your goal, right? But just think about that. Like I said, you can get off the bike, change clothes, wash off, wash your feet, no sleep. And then try to get some people involved with you. I failed at that my first time. The second time I did a full virtual Everesting, and it was better. It was awkward to have people, you know, see all the bikers sweat and be gross and everything, but you won't care after a few minutes anyway. So the last thing is how to submit and get your credit. So you'll go to the Everesting site and you'll click submit, but you have to have your Swift linked to your Strava. So just make sure you do that before and everything will be great. I hope this helps you. I've covered a lot and I know I'm talking a little fast. I'm excited for you. I want you to crush it. If you've got any questions, you know, put them in the comments. I'll do my best to answer them. I don't know what I'm going to do next on it. Maybe I'll just host and have a beer instead. But good luck to you. And I know you're going to crush it. Thanks. Bye.